Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Wa ba'd. Welcome to our Journey Through the Quran program, the second installment of it. Today we're going to be covering the second juz or para of the Quran. Keep in mind a juz is a 1/30th division of the Quran. So what people have done in the past, and you know, people and Muslim scholars, they said, you know, it'll be nice if we can read the Quran every month. So they divide it into 30 parts, because a month is usually 29 or 30 days in the Islamic calendar. So they said, let's divide it up into parts. 30 parts will be great. We can finish the entire thing in a span of a 130-day month. So that's what is a good classification or a good division of the Quran. And we'll be covering juz by juz, or 1/30th section every single day. So today we're covering the second juz, or the second 1/30th section of the Quran. Now we can't cover the entire thing because we only have 20 minutes. And then we're going to open it up for some Q&A. People can ask questions about it. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just briefly talk about some of the things that are mentioned in these verses. And then I'll go into detail on just one section. So that's kind of the way that I'm going to be covering it, inshallah ta'ala. So the second juz is covering Surah Al-Baqarah, verses 142 to 252. So Surah Al-Baqarah is the longest surah in the Quran. And the idea of a surah spanning more than one juz exists. So Baqarah is more than one. In fact, it's more than two juz. So just covering part of that surah. Now the verses that we're covering, 142 to 252 in the second juz, they talk about a lot of different topics. And it's important to understand the context of Surah Al-Baqarah. Some surahs in the Quran, or some verses in the Quran, they were revealed during the Meccan period, or the first 13 years of revelation of the Quran. And the other ones were revealed in the following 10 years afterwards, which is known as the Medinan period, where the Muslims and the Prophet, peace be upon him, had migrated from Mecca to Medina. So what you find is, you find a lot more social rules and details of acts of worship inside the Medinan surahs, or inside the surahs and the verses that were revealed after the migration to Medina, because Muslims had their own state, they had their own community, their own society. So Surah Al-Baqarah is one of those that was revealed after the migration. So there's a lot of detailed guidance mentioned in there. In these surah, in these verses, among the things that are mentioned are rules about fasting. In fact, the only place in the entire Quran that talks about fasting in detail are actually in these verses in the second juz. It also talks about Hajj, or the pilgrimage to Mecca. Then it talks about marriage, certain rules regarding marriage. It talks about divorce. It talks about the children and what happens after a divorce takes place to them. It talks about alimony or spousal support. It talks about wine or alcohol, drinking, you know, getting intoxicated. It talks about gambling. And a lot of other things. So there's a lot of different guidelines about how people should structure their social life, their family life, and their individual lives and acts of worship, all mentioned in these verses in detail, right? So it's really interesting to go through them, the verses, reflect on them, think about what they're trying to say. But what we'll do is I'm gonna focus specifically on the verses that come near the end of this section, near the end of the juz. And that is about the story of Jalut and Dawud and Talut. So Talut is oftentimes identified as Saul, and Jalut is Goliath, and Dawud is David. David was a prophet, Talut as well, or a king, and then Jalut. So this is really interesting because Christians grow up with the same story about the story of David and Goliath. And it's kind of a story that's known to a lot of people. In fact, there's a modern author by the name of Malcolm Gladwell. He recently wrote a book called David and Goliath. It really doesn't have that much to do with the story, but it's kind of an analysis about how the underdog, or a person who is perceived to be in a disadvantageous position, actually has a level of advantage. And some pretty interesting reflections, a few weird points here and there, but there's some really interesting reflections in that book. But the point really is that this story is known to Jews, it's known to Christians, it's known to Muslims, and it's even used by, you know, non-religious people as well, because it just has a lot of good moral lessons in there. So let's look at this story in detail, some level of detail here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and this is in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is chapter 2, verses 249, 250 and 251. Allah begins by saying, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم فلما فصل طالوت بالجنود قال إن الله مبتليكم بنهر. It says that when Talut, Saul, went out with his army, he said that Allah is going to test you with a nahar, with a river, right? So what does he mean he's going to test with the river? Let's continue with the story. فَمَنْ شَرِبَ مِنْهُ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي وَمَنْ لَمْ يَطَعَمْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي إِلَّا مَنِ اغْتَرَفَ غُرْفَةً بِيَدِهِ. It says that, and this is Saul, Talut, he made the announcement to his army, to his followers, to his people who are believers, they're Muslims. And there's an army setting out to go in combat and fight against people who are oppressive, right? So there's a case for an idea where, you know, fighting has to take place under the last circumstances where there's no way to stop oppression from happening. So he says to his followers and his army that whoever amongst you drinks this, whoever drinks from this river, فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي, you're not from me. You're not a true believer in me. You are not really part of my army. You are, you know, this is a very bad thing. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَطْعَمْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي, and whoever does not even taste it, then you're really part of me. Meaning you're part of my group. You're part of the Muslim community. You are somebody who's obeying instructions of your leader. إِلَّا مَنْ اِغْتَرَفَ غُرْفَةً بِيَدِهِ, you know, except whoever just takes one little handful of water. That's sufficient. You can't drink more than that. All you get is a little tiny taste, and we got to move on. Now, this is really interesting. So what is happening here is Talut is actually testing his own followers by saying, this is a test for you. There's nothing wrong with the water. I mean, we don't have any evidence that there's any problem with the water itself. But he wants people to be prepared. He wants to see if whether people are going to actually listen to him, whether they're going to obey, you know, what the leader is saying. And this is a great test to see who is true and who is not true. And it's interesting because we're fasting right now, right? So the people who are fasting right now and they're watching this video, you know, we would be hoping we could get, if we had a river of water and we were allowed to drink from it, we'd love to drink from it right now, because it's end of the day in California here. We're thirsty. We could use a little bit of water. But we're not allowed to even taste from it, not at all. Right? And for them, he was telling them, don't drink from this water. He gave them a concession. You could have a little tiny drink. We can't even do that. So we can understand that there's a temptation. There's a desire to want to do something. But we stop. We stop and we don't do that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know our Creator is watching us. So we say, no, we're not going to do that. Now, he is the leader of his people. His people are supposed to follow him. These are believers in Allah. These are believers in the prophets. And they're going out on a good mission and a good cause. So he's testing them. And that's an interesting lesson. It's an interesting lesson for people who are leaders. And it's an interesting lesson for people who are followers of leaders. For the leaders, they need to make sure that their followers are real followers. They're not sideline fans. You know, they're not just people who, you know, they kind of cheerlead the person along the way. But then when push comes to shove, when someone is actually needed to do some important action, the person is not there for their leader, right? It doesn't work that way. And those are not true followers. So if you don't have, if someone does not have true followers, then there's not really a community, right? Because there has to be some level of hierarchy, some level of leadership, some level of structure within a society for it to function properly, for it to actually have the benefit that it's supposed to bring, rather than just a bunch of individuals floating around randomly, trying to figure things out and trying to, you know, show some level of strength for a common cause. So that's one great example we find. And the example of the follower is that followers are supposed to actually listen to their leaders. You know, I mean, as long as they're not commanding them to do anything that's forbidden, anything that's against what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering, if a follower is saying, yeah, I'm part of the group, but I don't like the way you asked me, or I don't like this, I'm going to do it only if I think it's right. And that becomes a huge problem. You don't really have a community. You don't have a group, right? Just imagine the Muslim community. Imagine something were to happen. Muslims need to go as a group to, you know, maybe protest or demand their rights for proper treatment or something like that. 100 people show up outside of an important politician's office, and they're trying to make an announcement. And everyone goes in their own mind. They say, look, don't speak until the leader of the assembly of Muslims goes and addresses people first. And people say, well, I'm not going to wait for that. I'm going to say something right now, or I'm going to bring my own banner, my protest banner. I'm going to write whatever I want on there. You know, no one can tell me what to do. You know what? That you're not going to have strength in numbers. If everyone wants to do whatever they want to do, whenever they want to do it, and they have no respect for any level of authority, it's going to break up the entire group. And that's why this idea of having respect for proper authority, we're not talking about listening to dictators and tyrants. We're talking about a person who is a legitimate, righteous, just, wise leader. That person needs real followers, and the followers, they need to be real followers. They need not to be pretend followers. When that person puts themselves in harm's way and they think they have people behind them, and then all of a sudden he looks back, hey guys, you're with me, right? He looks back, there's nobody there. Everyone's gone, everyone ran away. Those are not real followers. You don't have a real community there. So this is what's happening with Talut. And then he continues and he says, the story continues. فَشَرِبُوا مِنْهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْهُمْ. They drank from it, except a few of them. Meaning, most of his army, most of the army that he has out there going, assuming that these are believers, these are followers, these are people who are going to be with him, actually the majority of them disobeyed. I mean, that's horrible. You know, إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْهُمْ. Except a few, only a small group of them actually listened to what he was saying. The rest of them were disobedient. They didn't even follow what he's saying. So the story skips. It just continues, but it skips one scene. This فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَهُ هُوَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ قَالُوا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا الْيَوْمَ بِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ. He says that when they crossed the area, him and the believers along with him, they said, لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا الْيَوْمَ. We have no strength over Jalut, over Goliath. Goliath was this very powerful leader who had a very powerful army, but they were tyrannical. These were corrupt people. These were oppressors, right? Like modern day oppressors. These are oppressors who are powerful. They're strong. They're well organized. They're well equipped. They have a strong army. And what happened is when they crossed over, a lot of his army is disobedient to him. They won't even follow him when he said, you know what, only take this much water or don't drink from it. And most of them disobeyed. There was a small group of believers with him. So what is their response? Their response is, we have no power over such a strong army like Goliath. Like we could never, you know, look at this. We're outnumbered. We're outmatched. There's no point in fighting. We are failures. We will never be able to succeed. All this pessimism just starts to fill up the entire army. And then Allah continues. قَالَ الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا اللَّهِ كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. He says, the ones who are certain that they are going to meet Allah, that they're going to meet God, they said, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلًا. How many small groups or weaker groups have been dominant and achieved victory over a larger group by the permission of Allah, meaning by the help of Allah? You see the difference, right? You see a world of difference in two reactions. The reaction of people who were listening to their leader, who were listening and obeying, and they didn't drink from the water. They said, you know what? We can do this. Optimism. If we have Allah on our side, we have the help of Allah, we can handle this. We got it. The people who are disobedient, the people who are scared, they end up saying, we're going to fail. We can't do it. Let's run away. We're not going to be able to achieve anything. And that's the mentality of two people. And Allah is trying to tell us to be in the mentality of the latter group. Be in the mentality of people who put their full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be in the mentality of the people who know that with the help of Allah, anything can be achieved. And they mention a beautiful point. They're not just blindly putting their hope in Allah. They're actually mentioning historical proof. They're saying there's historical proof that smaller groups of people have been able to overcome larger groups of people. So why should we go into panic mode? Why should we be so pessimistic about it? Why should we think this is not possible? This has happened. It's not impossible. We're not saying one person's going to go fight against 1,000 people and we'll just put our trust in Allah. That's not what's happening here. There was a large enough group and saying, we can do it. We're able to do it with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu ma'a sabirin. And Allah is with those who are patient. This is Allah telling us, if you're patient, you put your trust in Him, you can handle this. This is the story of Talut and Jalut and Goliath, when the two armies are fighting. And the story continues. وَلَمَّا بَرَزُوا لِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And it says, when they came out and they appeared in front of Jalut, in front of Goliath and his army, his massive army, they said, Rabbana, our Lord, pour patience upon us and strengthen our feet and help us against these disbelieving people, against these tyrannical people. So they were firm when they came out, the people who had firm hope in Allah, they kept on asking Allah for help. They kept on making dua for help. And then Allah tells the details of Allah skips the details of the story and He gives the summary. Because the details of the story are mentioned in other scriptures. Many people are aware of the details, and we don't even need the details in this context. And He says, فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. They defeated them by the permission of Allah, with the help of Allah. وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ وَآتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَعَلَّمَهُ مِمَّا يَشَاءُ. He says, and David and Dawood, he killed Goliath. So David is known to be not anywhere near or as strong as Jalut, as Goliath. But he was actually the one on the battlefield. He was one of the firm believers. Dawood, David, becomes King David. He becomes a prophet later on. His son is Suleiman, Solomon, also becomes a powerful king. He says David was on the battlefield that day in the army of Talut. And what happened? He was able to actually slay the leader. They were able to be victorious. And then it says, and Allah gave him kingdom. He gave him power and authority to David, to Dawood. And He gave him hikmah and wisdom. You know, just getting power and political authority, it's not enough. A lot of politicians, you know, they think, if I can just get elected, a lot of other political parties, if we could just get into power, everything will be fine. No, you need hikmah. You need wisdom. If you don't have wisdom, if you don't have proper knowledge, what are you going to be able to achieve? You know, you may have had a good intention in the beginning, but if you don't know how what you're doing, you don't know how to govern, you're not have good leadership qualities, it's not going to be sufficient. Allah gave those qualities to Prophet Dawood, and that's why he was a great leader. وَعَلَّمَهُ مِمَّا يَشَاءُ. And He taught him whatever he wanted. I mean, Allah taught him other things, meaning He made him a prophet. He taught him about revelation. He taught him about how life is supposed to be lived. He taught him about how to convince people that there's only one God, that there's only Allah. And then Allah concludes with this statement, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ. So if it was not for Allah repelling people by each other, if it was not Allah's causing one group to repel another group, to stop another group, لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ, the earth, the world would have been in corruption. It would have been in dismay. It would have been ruined. Meaning that there are people out there who do some really bad things. And the people who do bad things, they need to be stopped. And who's going to stop them? In the past, some communities, Allah stopped them. Allah destroyed the people of Noah. Allah destroyed the people of Lut. He destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. He destroyed the people of Lot for all the indecencies that they were doing. Allah destroyed the people of, you know, Hud and the people of Salih, you know, Ad and Thamud. But afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided, no, I'm not going to do that anymore. Now people need to stop other people. That becomes their test. Groups of people are responsible for stopping other people from doing wrong. So you and I, on an individual level, we need to do our part. On a societal level, we need to understand that we don't just sit back and wait and say, you know what, everything is going to be handled. We just make dua. And we don't play any role. All we do is we just ask Allah. No, people are being oppressed. Muslims are being oppressed. We have a role to play. Other people are starving. They don't have enough food to eat. We have a role to play. You know, economics, people are exploiting the economic system. They're either, you know, supporting big, powerful groups and lobbies and corporations. We have a role to play. There's something that we should be doing. This is injustice. And that type of injustice needs to be put in check. And who's going to put it in check? It needs to be communities. It needs to be groups. Not just, you need more than just an individual. And how do you get a strong community and a strong group? You need to have a leader, and you need to have leaders. There could be more than one group, and you need to have real followers who are not so selfish. They're not so self-absorbed, and they're actually going to follow their leader. And if they're not going to follow their leader, then they don't have a good group. And if they have a corrupt leader, an unwise leader, or an impious leader, they're not going to have a good group. So all of these things are required, and Allah is bringing all of this down, setting it all up for us. And then He says, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. But Allah is showing favor over the entire world. Allah is merciful. Allah is compassionate over the entire world. Meaning that, you know what? Sometimes the things don't happen the way they're supposed to happen, and Allah still shows some level of mercy. Still shows patience. He still helps people. Even though they're not doing what they're doing, He still aids in that sense. So we have to do our part. And even though we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is great, Allah can do whatever He wants, Allah can take care of everything, there is a level of responsibility that we have as individuals and as communities. So this is what I wanted to share in this second juz here. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to understand His book. We ask Allah to help us to apply the lessons that we're supposed to be learning from His book into our lives, into our communities, into our societies. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this the best Ramadan for us, to bring us closer to Him, to accept our fasting, and to accept our prayers. Ameen. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nastaghfiruka Allahu wa natubu ilayk. We will take a few questions if there are any. And if not, then we will conclude. Okay. Looks like there's no questions, which is fine. So if anyone ever does have any questions, they can always email me. You can go to our website, iaoc.com, and you can find the contact information and send a message there. Inshallah. Have a good iftar. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.